teaching that the way to have salvation is through the death and resurrection of Jesus. And he hardly ever mentions Jesus' teachings. And when he does mention his teachings, he doesn't, you know, they're not central teachings to what Jesus appears to have taught. And so the question is, are they preaching the same religion? When you think of Christianity, Christianity is usually thought of as a religion based on the death and resurrection of Jesus. Well, is that what Jesus' own religion was about? Was that what he was preaching? And if not, then isn't Christianity the religion about Jesus rather than the religion of Jesus? And if so, isn't Paul the one who kind of does that, who creates this thing we call Christianity? So that's the kind of issue that we're dealing with in the course, the relationship of Paul and Jesus, where they're similar, but also where they're very, very different.
I've really enjoyed this question for a long time and learning from you and other academics. I want to take just a deep dive into some of this. I know you're going to go into the course extensively on this idea, but there have been several academics I've interviewed who kind of coined the phrase that Paul's kind of the creator, or maybe they won't use the word creator, but they'll say he is the originator of what we call Christianity. However, he has this weird list in 1 Corinthians 15 where he claims people before him supposedly were eyewitnesses, probably visionary states or something, it depends on who you're reading, of Jesus' resurrection, a resurrected Jesus. He also persecuted Christians, as you've mentioned elsewhere. So what is he persecuting them for? What is their message? Are they already preaching a death, burial, resurrection idea about Jesus? Or could this be something different? And that Paul, as he says in Galatians 1, he receives this gospel through revelation, not of man, but directly from Christ. I don't know the answer, but that's why I'm interviewing you, to get you to tease us for your course, because I'm sure you're going to go into several of these things.
Were these New Testament scholars who've said that Paul originated Christianity? You don't need to name names, but I mean, are they experts?
Yes, there are some New Testament scholars that would say, I guess you'd say, what we consider Christianity.
Yeah, that Paul was the founder of Christianity. Okay, yeah, that's been a line that was around, used to be a very common line. I think it's less common now, because most people recognize what you say, which is that Paul himself heard about Christianity before he became a Christian. And so whether or not he was persecuting people, it's almost, I think he certainly was persecuting people, but I think the problem is that if you look at Paul's chronology, if you look at, like when Paul writes his letters, he sometimes say, you know, 3 years later I did this, and then, you know, 15 years later I did that. You know, you get these chronological designations. And what historians do is they take these chronological things and they take the letters and they take the book of Acts. They kind of put it all together. It's a complicated process. People spend years doing this. But when you do all this stuff, when you crank it all out, it looks like Jesus converted to be a follower of Jesus about 3 or 4 years after the crucifixion. And so
you mean Paul, you said Jesus converted to become a Christian.
Oh, well, you know, right. We'll call that an orthodox corruption. that's a corruption of the text, only as a correct. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Yeah. No, Jesus never did convert. Paul converted 3 or 4 years after the resurrection. And so to say that he originated Christianity would mean that there was no Christianity. There was nobody who believed in Jesus before, during those first 3 or 4 years. And that strikes me as completely implausible, especially because he himself talks about having arguments with those who were apostles before him. what were the apostles of exactly? And so I think it's implausible to say he started the whole thing. It would be fair to say that he promoted Christianity more than anyone else that we know of in the period. He developed the theological ideas of Christianity more than anyone else we know of in the period. Historically, he's far more important than anyone else in the period except for Jesus. That doesn't mean that he's the originator of Christianity, though. It means it means something else. I mean, you know, Darwin was not the first who came up with the idea of evolution, but, you know, we talk about him as if he was. But of course, he had predecessors who were starting to lean this way, and he had special ideas of his own. Paul had special ideas of his own. And when you quote Galatians 1, this is really key because almost everybody misunderstands that verse. So Paul says two things in two different places that that have to be combined to understand his situation. In 1 Corinthians 15, as you pointed out, he says that he learned from others that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures and was raised from the dead according to the scriptures. And then he was seen by Cephas and the 12, etc. So Paul says he's learned this from other people. In Galatians, he says that his gospel was given by revelation and not from any human. Those two things sound like they're at odds with each other, but they're not at all at odds with each other because he's not talking about the same thing. In 1 Corinthians 15, he's not talking about his version of the gospel. He's talking about the understanding of Christianity that every follower of Jesus had, that Jesus died and was raised from the dead. His gospel in Galatians is quite clear. If you read, just read Galatians 1 and 2 very carefully, his gospel is his particular understanding of the death and resurrection of Jesus, which says that Gentiles don't have to become Jews in order to be followers of Jesus.
If I may, just to interject here, to splice this up a little more into detail, is that death, burial, resurrection was probably already an established belief or understood thing within the Christ movement or the Jesus movement. Paul is not the originator of that. What Paul seems to be the pioneer on is, oh my goodness, I'm on a mission to the Goyim, to the Gentiles, to the ethne, and the nations. And this is my gospel, that they do not need to be, they do not convert to Jew, to become a Jew in order to have salvation.
Yes, I think that's absolutely the right, I think that's right. I don't think there can be much debate about that, really. I think, yes.
Let me ask you a tough one.
There's debate about it, but there's debate about everything. But I mean, yeah, no,
I'm sure this is a nut you're going to try and crack when you do the course, but how do we really know what Jesus taught, right? I mean, you get this all the time, and I know that you've written several books. You're going to go into this in your course. Can we honestly trust, looking at these gospels, you know, I'm with you on the text critical and looking at this as a skeptical kind of what Jesus really said. Did he really talk about his death, burial, and his resurrection, or is this ad hoc or something added, you know, to him after his death by the authors? In several places, it seems to give that nod that the author is putting into Jesus' mouth, or some of his parables sound like something the temple's already destroyed and they're writing some type of parable, which makes sense of that kind of criteria. How do we know that this is what Jesus taught?
Yeah, well, it is a very complicated question, a long question, it's a subject of several of my books. And so I won't give you the book link answer here. You'll be glad to know. The basic answer is that you treat the Gospels like you treat any other historical source. Many people object to that. Conservative Christians think you cannot treat them like any other source because they're inspired by God. But historians understand that inspired by God is a theological claim, and historians don't base their analysis on one theology or another. They don't base it on a theological claim. So the conservative Christians object to it, but also people on the far left object to it as well, because they say, look, the Gospels are in the Bible. You can't trust the Bible sources because they're not historical sources. They're biblical sources. They're theological books. My response, and I think both groups are completely wrong. It is true that Matthew is in the New Testament. Matthew, though, did not think he was writing the scriptures of the New Testament. Matthew was writing a book about Jesus based on stories he heard. Yes, he believed in Jesus. But he still was recording events that he heard about. That's what a historical source is. unless he's making up everything whole cloth, then he's basing it on stories that were in circulation. That's true of Mark, Luke, and John as well. And so, since they're basing it on stories that have been circulating, these are historical sources that are treated like other sources that contain hearsay, that contain inaccuracies, that contain contradictions, that contain implausibilities. We have lots of ancient sources like that. We don't discount them as historical sources. We don't say, well, you can't trust anything. And you can say that, but you could say that about any, you know, if you have a, suppose you have a soldier from the Second World War. Suppose you have two soldiers. Suppose you have a German soldier and an American soldier from the Second World War that are both describing the Battle of the Bulge. And let's say these soldiers weren't actually in the Battle of the Bulge, but they heard them from buddies, okay? So if you're trying to reconstruct what happened at the Battle of the Bulge, do you ignore sources like that? Oh yeah, but you know, the German has his German view, and he thinks, you know, the American has the American view, so like, you can't use them because they're biased. Of course not. You look at what they have to say, you compare them to one another, you can look at plausibilities, and you do a historical analysis that's based on, do you have independent attestation of events? Is something clearly expressing the bias of one party or another? Is another, you know, I mean, these are the kinds of things you look at, whether you're doing the Second World War or the historical Jesus. And so you can't just throw out the Gospels because they're in the Bible, because the authors didn't know they were writing the Bible. They were just writing stories of Jesus then.
Before we move forward on this, it's really interesting, is what if one views the gospel genre not in historiography at all? What if they're looking at them in a more mythic, some mythic category, or something that maybe looks similar? Matthew and Luke kind of has a biographical look to it, cradle to grave, but Mark and John don't. So what if we're looking at the genre and it's not, you know, we're not looking at it as historiography? Can we then approach this and be, wouldn't that cause people to be more skeptical, I guess, on what we're reading as factual? And in that question, I guess, is like, you're taking the oral tradition kind of route, that there's like stories and oral things that are coming into the Gospels. There are other scholars, I'm sure you're aware, that try to go, well, we don't think that we should take the oral tradition route into what we're reading in the Gospels. They take more of a literary approach or something else. What are your thoughts about that?
Well, those are two very big questions. And I'd say they're questions that are different from each other. The first has to do with the genre of the Gospels.
Attending the US,
and, you know, if you want to grab it, like, I think you said the summit, mythical route.
And I believe that.
So I don't think what you do is you kind of choose something. You know, you pick something out of the air. I think you read a lot of ancient literature.
And I think that the Peace Corps has a role to play.
You try to see
in this whole unfolding partnership.
How literature works. So you have all sorts of different kinds of writings.
Working across the northern region.
You've got philosophers, and, you've got historians,
school,
which was you've got biographers, you've got people writing religious texts, you've got people writing myths, you've got people, you know, you've got, you've got hundreds of different
so
kinds of writings.
I know he comes from Alabama.
And so what you do is you read massively, and you try to figure out, well, how does this kind of
young people growing up,
how does this kind of group writings work together?
To
like
explore.
You have groups that are trying to do historiography, like suppose you've got histories of Rome. Okay, so how do they work? You know, their history, and so they're similar because they have this characteristic, this kind of, these are the characteristics, they have lots of things different from each other, but they have these characteristics
that
hold them together as a genre of literature. And you have these other things.
So
you got these myths,
you know,
and this is how
the
they work.
The
boom, 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 boom. And you've got poetry. You know, you've got epic poetry. This is what epic poetry
the
looks like.
To the other end with zero.
So this is what you do with modern literature, of course. You've got short stories. You got limerick
Mr.
poems. You've got biographies. You've got histories. You've got sports page articles. You've got things. And like all of these genres have things in common with each other. But the only way to know it is to read a bunch of them to see what the things in common are.
You know,
and then if you find it, if you pick up a book, suppose you pick up a book,
when I
and it doesn't have
US
a cover
Africa
on
summit,
it,
asked,
but you're reading this thing and you're trying to figure out what this thing is. Well, you look at what's written in it and you decide, is this a biography?
Africa
and America, is this a science fiction novel? Is this a collection of poems?
Worthwhile.
Right? Because you know what the genres are.
I believe that it's undoubted
so
that
when you approach the Gospels, that's what you do. You've read widely in Greek and Roman literature and you ask, what is this like?
You know,
is it like myths? Is it like Rome, like histories of Rome? Is it, you know, is it epics? Is it, what is it like? And so scholars who do that for a long time now have said, look, basically these are biographies. You know, there are a lot of biographies that do not begin with the birth of a person. Biographies can begin in mid-story if they want to. So there are certain generic features to biographies that biographers talk about. Plutarch, Suetonius, etc. We have biographies, and they're pretty darn similar to the Gospels. The Gospels are different, but they're not sui generis. They're not like their own thing. They're very much like biographies, especially biographies of religious people. They are far more like the biography of Apollonius of Tyana than they're like Hesiod's myths about Zeus. I think they are biography. Most biographies, biographers are basing their work on stories that they've heard. Sometimes written sources, sometimes stories. Plutarch, for example. We'll talk about all these about this person or that, this person, this story, this or that story. These are the different versions that he's heard, and he reports them. He's heard them. In the ancient world, almost everything, all traditions were passed along orally because most people were illiterate. My view is that if Christianity is spreading throughout the Roman Empire, as it had to do, it started out in Jerusalem. By the end of the first century, there were Christian communities that were scattered throughout Judea and out in Samaria, up in Syria, over into what's now Turkey, Asia Minor, over in Italy, down in North Africa, possibly down in Africa, possibly as far away as Spain. I mean, there are Christian communities in all these places. Most people converting are illiterate. So how are people converting people to believe in Jesus? Or not? How can you not have all traditions? You have some independent sources that tell very similar stories about Jesus. So they can't all be making it up because they're all similar stories.
By the way, just to add this caveat, I don't deny oral sources were definitely working. I guess my problem is, what do we know is really an oral source that goes back to, I don't think there's a way to falsify it in my mind, and that's the difficult trouble I have. When I interviewed Del Alston Jr., he's huge on oral source. I did a History or Not series with him and said, What do you think didn't happen historically, taking a reverse trail from the Gospels, kind of butting against apologetics that are out there? And he goes, I said, what do you think about the Jesus being tempted in the wilderness in the Gospel of Matthew? And he's like, well, if there's a memory, he kept using the term memory, like there's a memory behind some of this literature. He thinks it means that he was just someone who probably was casting out demons. And so he took up his story to be a memory, an oral memory to go back to Jesus casting out demons as some miracle work. And I don't say that's not, I can't say that's not true. I just don't think that for that case, right, that there's a good way to prove that that's the case. And so I'm wondering, use the oral approach, how far can you really confident that something really does go back to me? Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do. There are two questions that I think you're asking. One is, how do you know it goes back to an oral tradition at all?
Right.
Why don't you just say these gospel writers are elite literary people who are coming up with their stories? And so that's one question. Another question is, if in fact there are oral traditions behind these accounts, which I think there has to be. We can talk about that for a long time.
But I'm not in denial, by the way.
No, I understand. I know that some people are down there, but I think there has to be. If there are oral traditions, and how do you establish whether they are historical? That is going to be the question that has driven a lot of historical Jesus scholarship over the years now. And the... So I'll say something about it. One thing about Dale Alston's view about this is a memory. I think what Dale knows everything, so he knows this, but there are a lot of false memories. And so the fact you call it a memory doesn't mean that it has a historical root. people remember, I remember all sorts of things about my past that did not happen at all. And it's not like I used to look at the detail and kind of blew it up or exaggerated it and created a story out of a historical kernel. You don't have to have a historical kernel to have a rumor with no basis whatsoever. So I'll say that. So, yes, it could be a memory, but it could be a false memory. The book that I think is the most important book I ever wrote, nobody read, is about memory. And about memory stones. And about how oral traditions work. And how that relates to this world view. And my book isn't based on, New Testament scholars saying about oral tradition. It's based on what actual lecturers say about oral tradition. And anthropologists. And so if you want to know about oral tradition, what we do is you study social anthropology. That's what we do as learners. Reading social anthropologists, as well as psychologists who do psychological analysis of memory. When you do that kind of work, then you start to understand better how you understand how the tradition develops. And then the trick is you've got to try to figure out how to put it back in the past. But there are criteria that you need in order to know whether a story in the novels goes back to Jesus or not.
What we're reading in the Gospels, apart from some spots where we might think the author's putting in either Pauline theology or this death, burial, resurrection, what post happened to Jesus, let's ignore the stuff that you as a scholar and historian would say, hey, I don't think Jesus said that or did that. What do you think opposes Paul's teachings, and what does Paul say that you think opposes what you think Jesus actually said? Are there some teasers you can give us? Because I know your course is going to go into this, but are there any things you can tease us with to just say, I think Jesus probably said this, which would be a different thing than what Paul said here, and Paul says this, and they're in opposition?
Lots of things. And so, once again, it's important to differentiate between a contrast between Paul and the Gospels and a contrast between Paul and the historical Jesus. Those are two separate issues. Just to explain that for a second before I get to my question, I think you can show Paul and Matthew have a very good understanding of the Jewish. You can argue that, of course, but if you come and think that's right, so you got this verse in Matthew that says the Lord Jesus had to keep the law better than the scribes and the Pharisees, Matthew 5, verses 17 and 20, and that you've got to follow the law better than the scribes and the Pharisees, or you're not going to be able to do that. If you contrast that with Paul, who says no one is made right by the fall of the law, and the Gentiles don't have to follow the law, that kind of seems like paradox. So you can work that out. But that would be a contrast between Matthew and the law. The question, so that's one set of questions. That is a very, very, very important set of questions. Another important set of questions is the one that I do in the course, which is, what can you establish about what Jesus really himself actually said, and what Paul actually said, and are they at all? And so, this is where, of course, if you don't think you can know anything about it, you're not as good as our culture school. If you say that we're working hard, I'm sorry, but you know, for sure. Or if you say that this presidential candidate is clearly telling the truth and I know that he's lying, I'm sure. So I think it's important to be able to know, because I think the truth really matters. And the only way to know it's all the truth is through possibilities. Jesus taught that the way to enter that kingdom was by keeping God's commandments. To return to God, you're not obeying God. You need to return to God, you need to repent, and you need to completely commit yourself to God, and you need to start loving your neighbors yourself, helping those in need, taking care of the poor, the hungry, the homeless. You do those things, and you will enter the kingdom. I think you can show that's highly probable what Jesus taught. And it absolutely was not Paul taught. Paul taught that helping others is a good thing, and you should do that. But you are not capable of being good enough to satisfy God, because you are controlled by a power of sin that forces you into alienation from God. And the only way conquer sin is by believing in the death and resurrection of Jesus and being baptized. You do that, and then you can enter into the coming kingdom. Well, is that the thing? And so, like, one way to put this is, if Jesus is right, that you could turn your life around and start following the commandments and then enter into the kingdom, if Jesus is right about that, then why did he have to die? You can just turn your life around. Paul said he had to die. The death and resurrection is what matters. And if Jesus is right, that, you know, Jesus teaching the Sermon on the Mount, for example, is just filled with wonderful ethical teachings about how to live. Paul doesn't mention them. For him, he says that the only thing I knew among you was Christ and him crucified. That's the only thing that matters. It's not the only thing that matters to Jesus. He wants you to behave. Paul wants you to behave too, but he thinks you'll behave only when you believe in that. Wow. So I think they do it different.
There's so much there. I know I could go on and on about this. It makes me think of questions of, once Jesus died, what went through the minds, what transition took place in the immediate followers, who concocted or kind of invented, in a way, the kind of rituals we have, from the Lord's Supper to the baptism. These are really curious, interesting questions that I think maybe some of it's picked up from the Greco-Roman world. I mean, there seems to be common ritualistic things. I look at John Kloppenburg and his Christ Associations book, which is really interesting. You know, taking a heuristic approach. But I love what you're saying here. It really makes you want to get back to Jesus to know more about this guy, and even understanding Paul, right?
So you're not going to talk. And, you know, and so this course that I've done is kind of scratching the surface for both of them in order to show that. I don't argue that they're contradictory or anything like that. People could draw that conclusion. But, yeah. You know, is there continuity? Are they completely odds? Are they similar? How does all that work? And then, boy, yeah, you're right. Now you have these big issues about where do the Christian rituals come from. Now, baptism, probably not from the Greco-Roman world, but the Eucharist, probably from the Roman. So, yeah, that Christian history, it's a really interesting thing. So, but this to me, Jesus and Paul, is like one of the fundamental issues. The basic thing, is Christianity what Jesus preached or not? And if Paul's preaching is right, then how could Jesus' preaching be right? Whoa! Okay then.
Just so everybody knows what they will get here, you can go, you'll own it for life. 8 lectures, Paul and Jesus, the Great Divide. Did Paul and Jesus have the same religion? Be sure to sign up. Lots of questions gets answered. In fact, I know for a fact we didn't even touch the top of the tip of the iceberg. There's a lot in this course you'll get access to. And Bart, I look forward to seeing you there, my friend.
Yeah, thanks. Okay, I'm looking forward to
my bed. The sun shone on my face. My skin was red. My mouth was dry, just like a napkin. My bed was wet from the night before. I poured myself a cold glass of water. It tasted like a pair of jeans. So I went to the kitchen to refill my cup. Opened up the fridge. I couldn't find anything but a lonesome slice of fresh white bread. It felt like a sign. Felt like that bread was mine. I put the bread in the toaster. I pushed the button and watched the walls of the toaster begin to glow like the fires in the fields of the dim in World War I. Felt like I was standing there in Southwest France, 1914, with my hands on my gun. My body's lying on the ground, my neighbor's house at hand. Just inches from my peripheral view.